Hey everyone, before this episode of Countdown to Infinity and Avengers podcast, I just wanted to let you know of a great way you can support the podcast during these troubled times. You can go to patreon.com/delphinpod, D-E-L-F-I-N-P-O-D, patreon.com/delphinpod. It only costs $1 to support the pod there. And if you join our Avengers tier, we have episodes of Countdown to Infinity that is only there. I think this last time we talked about how COVID-19 affects the MCU, with Black Widow and the Eternals and everything else coming out this month. But all that is exclusive on patreon.com/delphinpod. You can also get ahead. You'll listen to episodes of this season before anyone else. We're already at Blade 2, Guillermo del Toro's Blade 2 there as well. You can also go to tpublic.com and search DelphinPod. You'll be able to look at shirts and merch. That's another way to support the pod. And if you don't want to spend any money, just rate and review and share with your friends. But without further ado, here's Fantastic Four. And just so you guys know, I'm going to introduce everyone. So don't say your name. No, I'm going to do it in a fun way. Welcome to Countdown to Infinity and
What's
Avengers.
Up? My name.
I gave you specific instructions.
I'm sorry. Continue.
Fuck. Welcome to Countdown to Infinity and Avengers podcast. We watch every single Marvel Cinematic Universe movie. We already finished that. We did that.
That's true.
We finished. Over.
It is done.
While we await the next phase of the MCU, we're watching the non-MCU movies and talking about these characters. Some of them are returning to the MCU soon. Some of them will never be in the MCU. Sorry, guys.
Oh, depressing.
It's a shitty thought.
But all of them are movies.
Yes,
that is true. Yes.
Okay, now I'm gonna go through the introductions. He can contour.
I told you we should have just said.
No, here we go. I'm gonna start left to right. He can contort and stretch all parts of his anatomy. At least that's what he tells the ladies. Our Mr. Fantastic, Andrew.
Heyo.
Just like the Thing, he is hard 24/7. It's John.
Hey, what's up?
Which John?
Like the Invisible Girl, you can find him stripped naked and running around public places, but unlike Invisible Girl, everyone can see him. It's Roy.
Your boy Roy.
While he may not be as temperature hot as the Human Torch, his body temperature as a result of the coronavirus continues to rise above normal levels. It's John.
We have two Johns. John squared.
I know.
How's it going?
And I'm Dr. Doom of the podcast, as in the CEO of a failing company and a murderer. If you don't know what movie we're talking about this week, we're talking about Fantastic Four. Is there a... like a subtitle?
No, it's just the 2005 version of Fantastic Four.
Interesting. It's funny that we're talking about it because there's so many iterations of it, of this movie.
I think even in, I think for Revenge of the Sequel, we even did the Josh Trank version at one point.
2015,
yeah.
Before we dive into it.
And Rise of the Silver Surfer at one point.
Oh, wow.
I think that was one of our earlier episodes.
I guess we're a fully Fantastic Four podcast now.
Yeah.
Before we dive into this movie, John and Roy, this is your first time on the non-MCU version of the show. What are some of your favorite Marvel movies that aren't, bookended by an Avengers?
Mm-hmm.
You mean non-MCU movies?
Yeah.
Probably like Into Spider-Verse.
Oh, okay.
Ooh, good choice.
He took the good one.
Yeah.
John, I gotta say first. Yeah.
Roy said the right answer.
I mean, that's probably
the
first of the crop.
Three X-Men. I didn't hate First Class.
Oh,
First Class is good.
Unlike me on an airplane, those guys are snotty. That's the kind of podcast this is. A lot of good wordplay.
Yeah, dad jokes, puns.
Don't you dare put that on me. I ain't no father. What are your favorite superheroes, do you think? Because I know that the movies are sometimes we see like repeats of certain heroes, and then we see different iterations. I think we talked about the Punisher a couple weeks ago.
Yeah.
And there's multiple versions of them. Do you have are you a Tobey Maguire Spider-Man guy, or do you guys like Hugh Jackman, the Jacked Man?
Okay, for Spider-Man, I actually like Andrew Garfield. I know it sounds super weird and people are going to hate it, but like his suit in Amazing Spider-Man 2.
Oh, you've been canceled.
Right? No, I love his suit in Amazing Spider-Man 2. I thought that was like the most comic accurate one.
It's just hard to Like, cause Andrew Garfield doesn't look like a nerd.
No, yeah, yeah.
Like, he looks like he's way too, like,
looks hot. Looks like he fucks bitches.
To be, yeah, exactly. Like, he looks like a, like.
Just
yeah.
like my pet dog. Who also.
Well,
I don't.
Well, I mean, not Andrew Garfield. Tom Holland, Spider-Man is fucking, like, he's been through, like, two chicks already.
Oh, that's totally true. I guess so. Yeah. Like,
cool.
Now, when you put it that way, I'm just like.
Spider-Man's no longer a. Pussy repellent.
No, not at all.
Spider-Man's hot AF. Cool.
Yeah, we love you, Spider-Man.
Wait, when you said Andrew Garfield and then John?
Oh, yeah.
Tom Holland's that's a pussy magnet. But if we're just choosing like out of Spider-Man, I guess I'll go Tom Holland. That's what this became, even though it wasn't the question.
Yeah, it really wasn't.
You just said he's a pussy magnet. Well,
magnet.
Speaking of pussy magnets, my name's Emmanuel. No, I'm
That was actually perfect. That was a good
but,
timing.
We're talking about Fantastic Four. What do you guys think of this? I don't want to say character, but this group of superheroes, really, really huge for Marvel in the comic books. Their direct, response to the Justice League, which came out a year before, I think, the first Fantastic Four, this may be fake news, came out. But what do you guys think about Fantastic Four just in general before we talk about this movie?
They're the first family. They're Marvel's like first, it took the popularity with the superheroes started with, at least on the Marvel side, with Fantastic Four from when I remember. Marvel, and then after that, you get Spider-Man, you get the Hulk. It's really hard for some reason to do these movies on film for some reason. Even though I do like this one.
I actually like this one.
Excuse me. I think this movie is actually really cool, and it's really obviously of its time. Hmm. It's a very fun, like, you know, 2000s superhero movie. But the characters themselves are super important. Like, you understand why, because they didn't have the rights. But, like, yeah, I mean, these characters should be in the MCU, because, like, Reed Richards is one of, the smartest people in the Marvel Universe. And he usually works together with, like, Tony Stark and that,
the
you know.
Illuminati.
Yeah, and then you get, like, a...
Jay-Z, Beyonce.
You get really cool characters.
The Illuminati?
The seven strongest.
Yeah, it's like Professor X, Doctor Strange.
Those are the people who send the Hulk off into space for World War Hulk, yeah. Or for Planet Hulk.
You get, like, a bunch of, like, really cool supporting characters with Fantastic Four. Like, you get the Skrulls, you get the...
Galactus.
You get Galactus, so you get Dr. the Silver Doom. Surfer, Doctor Doom.
Mole Man.
Annihilus.
Black Panther.
Annihilus, yeah. Like, all the great stuff really just comes from Fantastic Four, and mm-hmm. It's kind of weird that we don't have them yet in the MCU.
Is it so Fantastic Four, Marvel had issues, we talk about their bankruptcy a lot, but they're far from it now, but they, one of the first most, what they thought was the most profitable superhero group that they could sell or license were the Fantastic Four. There's a really famous story of a version that came out in the 90s.
Arrested Development makes fun of it.
A
quote unquote lost version that was literally just made so that they can, so the studio could keep the rights. That'd be a fun documentary. Hey, documentarians, make that documentary. Because apparently the director and the filmmakers of that movie thought they were making a movie, and the studio the whole time knew that they weren't going
to. This is a joke.
Right? Yeah, they weren't going to release it ever. They were like, yeah, sure. What's the minimum amount we have to spend in order to keep the rights? That'd be a good doc. But then we got this version, and I consider this maybe the 2005 maybe the first real version from 20th Century Fox with a pretty big budget, and I guess
some pre-pubescent Captain America
you love saying prepubescent. It's like your favorite word.
What are you talking about?
It's
you,
on your Tinder
you say
profile
cuck a lot. What was the other one that we were talking about? Edging.
Ooh, edging. Yeah.
There's a couple of them that you say.
These are shirts. All of these are shirts. But what are well, let's talk about this movie, 2005. Did you guys watch this movie in the theaters when it came out? You were all alive, right?
Mm-hmm.
None of you are.
I think I was dead. Actually,
I saw it in theaters.
You were a soup that people were eating.
Yeah, I actually don't know. John, do you remember if we saw this in theaters?
I can't remember if we saw this one in theaters.
I don't think so. Yeah. I don't imagine that I was a big Fantastic Four fan, because unlike them, like Spider-Man had the cartoons, and they had those the Iron Man cartoon, and even the Secret Wars episode where like Cap popped out, and
Fantastic
all these
Four. Hey, Fantastic Four cartoon was awesome.
Four had a cartoon.
That's what I'm saying. It's like, no, I didn't watch it.
Yeah,
I actually had no exposure to them at all.
We still kind of knew about it though, because like you can tell, like, you know, everyone knows it's clobbering time, and for some reason I've known that line since I was a kid, like, and I knew it came from the thing.
Is it because of those giant foam hands that everyone had slamming together?
Yeah, I guess so. I do remember. I was familiar with the cartoon as a kid.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of my my bullies were big thing fans. They would scream, "It's clobbering time!"
Right before they clobbered you,
clobbered me. Spread your cheeks. And I thought I was the invisible girl. Took all my clothes off. Just made it worse.
The amount of clobbering.
Yeah.
Oh, well. Clobbered.
Whatever. I slowly poisoned them. So.
Oh, shit.
But what? So this movie, when it came out, what did you guys think about it?
I was a kid. You know, I had to be like 14. I think I was very happy with it.
Everyone who was good at math. Reverse engineer how old John is now. 14, 2005, let's see. He's 87? Holy shit.
That explained my fucking hair loss.
But you said you were a kid. I think there's enough in this movie if you're a kid to be excited. It's really bright and colorful, and the jokes you get as a kid, you're like, oh, yeah, that's
funny.
Yeah,
it's a family movie, kind of. Like, there's some, like, weird...
And then Jessica Alba's, like, half naked.
Yeah, there's some weird, obviously, like, sexualized parts and stuff.
He's like, I made these suits especially for you, and Jessica Alba's is the only one with, like, a plunging, like...
I have a really fucked up fact, a behind-the-scenes fact, and that's Jessica Alba was cast, and after that, they wrote a lot of the scenes in... where she had to like take her clothes off and be in lingerie after they knew it was Jessica Alba.
Understandable.
And that's
that makes sense.
And we, like, said it was a family movie.
Yeah,
I know.
I mean, there's a lot of, like, you know, because like Johnny Storm on the opposite end of that, like, kind of has a lot of, like, you know,
he does.
There's trap scenes too.
He's
as well.
Up, like, he straight up Me Too's the girl. Like, he like kisses her and he's like, all right, hey, join me at the thing. I was like, damn, you would have been canceled hardcore 2020. You would have been done.
Maria Menounos, for some reason, makes a cameo as like a nurse, Menounos.
Oh, yes,
like,
yes. From the theater.
With that stupid lady jokes, like, you're hot. Thanks, you too. Like,
yeah, exactly.
Oh, God, there's so many of those
thanks,
things.
So are you.
You're on fire.
He steals, he steals her jacket or leaves her like in a jacuzzi.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
Well, that's what I'm saying. I know you're.
It's so weird.
I mean, it's not a rated G movie in any way, but it is a very, it's a universal movie. I know John wanted a hard R.
Fantastic Four. So did Josh Trank, apparently, and he never got it.
Here, I'm going to slip you a copy of Fantastic Four Inches, which is...
What?
Which is my fanfic.
It's your autobiography.
Like, it's my picture.
Yeah. It's my autobiography.
It's my spec solo Fantastic Four porno. And I had to spend a hefty amount on the CGI to double up to that four. But yeah, well, you watched it recently. We all watched it recently. It was on Hulu.
Yes,
I have a sad story of me procrastinating and wanting to see it today.
Oh, yeah,
today.
I saw that.
On the first of the month.
Right.
It's gone.
He was texting me while we were watching it, and I texted him a picture, Roy, and Roy was like, it's not on Hulu. And I was like, bro. And I texted him a picture of my TV of like
the scene. We saw it, right?
We watched, like, I guess we were watching, like, they pulled the stream immediately after that.
That's what I was looking at.
That's really cool to kind of know how that works and how they won't stop the movie on you, like, midway. It's like, hey, it's midnight. You can't watch this shit anymore.
Dude, I was looking for it. Like,
yeah, I thought it was funny. At first, I thought, I was like, maybe he doesn't have the HBO package.
I don't.
No,
is it on HBO?
No, I thought that's what it was. I thought that's what it was.
Well, which is funny because right now, if you're listeners and you think, wow, this sounds like a really good movie, I want to watch it. You can't.
Are they saying that?
Yeah, I don't know.
You're imagining they're saying that.
It's going to come out in 2 months or some
shit. It's a great movie.
But
it's actually,
we don't know how it's going to be accessed because one of the biggest things of this movie, it's a 20th Century Fox movie, and 20th Century Fox was bought by Disney, and Disney owns Hulu. So it's who knows where the fuck you're gonna watch it. Just buy it.
Yeah, no, after like I messaged him, I went on Disney Plus, I went on Netflix, I went on Amazon.
You might say Instagram.
Yeah, Instagram.
You're find that movie.
Yeah, I was trying to find it. So I went to John's shop and I bought it.
Yeah, that's right.
Grindr
earlier. Yeah.
I got it a different way.
Oh wow. I didn't think we were allowed to talk about
download.
We won't. We and I got a screener.
Yeah. God damn it.
I'm voting for them for the
up,
one
Dolphin?
Of my neighbors was watching it and I sat outside the window.
And I was already peeping on him.
And he just happened to watch Fantastic Four. You're like, oh shit.
I was gonna say that I got it as a screener because I'm gonna write it in for best picture of this year. instead of what, 1970?
Melee back to 2005
instead of almost like
Joker.
Instead of Joker. Speaking of Joker, this movie is pretty fucked up. What did you guys think of the movie? Like now with your adult eyes, and again, John is 87, so he has like super adult eyes.
I want to hear this from Roy.
Yeah, what did you guys think of this movie?
I liked it. I still like it. It does have some pretty bad jokes, but like when people like talk about the MCU and they're like, they have cheap jokes, I'm like, no. Like, I think of these movies, I'm like, this is cheap jokes. Like, it was just like, eye roll. Like, that scene I told you, like, wow, you're so hot. He's like, thanks, you too. And I was just like, God damn it. Like,
yeah.
I mean, it's still, I really liked it a lot.
This movie crawled so Green Lantern can run.
Right?
Into a wall.
Yeah. Which is funny, though, because, like, I think, like, there's a... Oh, sorry, John. You go with your tangent. I was just like,
okay, now I want to go.
Movies eventually, like, kind of like, I don't know, they kind of hit the tone as Fantastic Four, because like some MCU movies are very similar in tone, mm-hmm. not as like lighthearted as this one, obviously, but like I want to say like maybe the Thor: The Dark World is the one that's coming to mind whenever I'm thinking of like the tone.
Before we move past this, I just want to say that you're right about the movie hitting the Fantastic Four tone, because I kept telling myself like there's something here. There's something here. It's buried under a bunch of shit. Stupid, but there's something here, and I can't put my finger on it.
Well, there is definitely something there. Because I think like even, I don't know, like I used to like this movie a lot for some reason. I don't know why I liked this version of Doctor Doom a whole lot, but now as an adult, like you're watching it and it's pretty stupid. Like this version of Victor Von Doom is really dumb.
How dare you.
But again, like there's something like at the very end when they're all fighting like that, like there's something there about it. Yeah.
Yeah. So it's funny that you say that, because I was the same way, where I'm like, I know this movie's bad, but I can't tell you what's bad about it. Like, it's weird. Like, I'm watching it and I'm like,
it's definitely the jokes and like the corniness. It's super corny.
John's about to fucking tell you.
So to be honest, I could probably argue that these jokes were made a lot maybe back in 2002 and they was or 2005, where it wasn't as like now we're cultured and like
Joker, we grew up, 11 nominations, exactly.
And now we were like, that's bad. But back in the day, I bet you people were like, that's a normal movie. You
know? I have some insight on the joke stuff. Chris Columbus, who at the time was like the whiz kid screenwriter, Home Alone,
Harry Potter,
Harry Potter. Makes sense, yeah. He wrote a draft of this, and it was the tone of it was Batman, the 60s Batman was the tone of the first script, and the director Story, what is his name? Tim Story?
Tim Story, yeah.
Had to change it and got rid of, according to him, like 80% of the jokes. There's even a utility belt joke in this.
Yeah.
And Columbus really wanted this to be that kind of movie. The film, their two movies impacted the way this movie was, because it took so long for this movie to come out. The first was Spider-Man.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And Spider-Man, tonally, Spider-Man was, there were moments of levity, but it's a very serious movie.
Right. It's a serious take on superheroes. Because I think there's an old school mentality, which is like, you know, pre-MCU, but even pre-Spider-Man, like, you know, that superhero movies are kind of like, they're cartoons. You know what I mean? Like, you know, like Batman and
silly.
Robin.
I hate it.
Yeah, exactly.
There's one-liners.
Yeah, exactly. Like, everybody, you know, you're wearing a costume. Yeah. It's kind of tongue-in-cheek.
And it's interesting because we talked about Spider-Man last week. I don't know when it'll be released, but Spider-Man changed that. And there are definitely goofy moments that are, you know, just something that Sam Raimi likes to do in his movies. But the rest of it is just a pretty well-grounded, small, emotional movie. The second movie that really impacted what we ended up with
here is
The Incredibles.
Yeah. Yeah.
They said, okay, if we're going to do funny, we might as well make fun of the superhero tropes. And then Incredibles came out, and it does that in a really good way.
In an almost identical way, too. Because
four
like everybody,
superheroes.
They have very similar powers, too. Like,
yeah. So I guess partly it's just what was left is what we ended up getting. Yeah. And we say what we want about the movie, but it succeeded. We'll talk about that towards the end. There is a sequel. And
yeah, and then the cast, I mean, the cast is cool. Like,
yeah, well, I was going to say, I liked everyone minus Jessica. I feel like her dialogue and her jokes were like the worst.
To be honest, she's a bad actress.
Yeah.
Yes.
Well, like, she's the one that took me out. Yeah. And I feel like that's...
I'm sorry, Jessica Alba.
Hold on, let me see where I should cut this out.
No.
I don't know if she's like a bad actress. I just think that this isn't like her.
I think it's not just, because I know it's not just in this one. And that's so like, it would suck if you were like, oh, like, yeah, I mean, she's like, the one that sucks the most, like in this specific movie. It's like, no, she's like very flawed in every single movie.
Like, Good Luck Chuck, that masterpiece.
Yeah, exactly.
Her wedding scene in Silver Surfer.
Yeah, we.
I was like, she's actually getting married. Like, I felt it.
To like Reed Richards, it's pretty funny. Like,
but yeah, well, yeah, well, let's talk about the cast. Or did everyone get to say what their first?
We skipped over John.
Yeah, I was gonna say, like, John, you kind of were left behind.
I did get left behind, like a poor child.
But they got a little real right there. Yeah,
the 87-year-old man. Yeah, did you have? Do you want to say like what your?
Yeah, I guess like I said earlier, I liked it as a kid. I'm watching it again as an adult for the first time in I don't know 15 years or whatever. It's like,
okay, hold on, let me do the math.
It's weird, not right? 87. It's a weird experience watching it.
It is
back as
really
a,
weird. Yeah. I like because I like I said like we were saying there is something here and I felt it and I couldn't put my finger on it because it was. There was so much more that was bad. Johnny Storm was just an unlikable piece of shit the entire movie.
I was
like, I hate this guy. I don't remember ever feeling that reading a Fantastic Four comic.
He kind of reminded me of his character in Knives Out, just like a douchebag, like just like, you know, walking
in. Ransom?
Yeah, exactly. Man.
It's really funny, though, because like, is that like... Yeah, I guess it's just the way the writing is, but it's also like it's a testament to...
it's supposed to be like a brother thing between him and Thing, but he's just like an absolute bully. Yeah, there's no back and forth.
You know, this is all an interesting thing that we're talking about because there is a another version of this movie that goes hard the other way, the 2015 Josh Trank version, where it is like we're going to just dive deep into the sibling stuff or the... like the fucked up nature of relationships. So it's interesting that we didn't get like a middle ground between those two things. I think talking about Human Torch being the way he is and talking about how Invisible Girl has some regrettable arcs and things.
Girl. Invisible woman.
Invisible Girl.
He calls him a girl in the
movie. I hated that. She also hated it. The movie made fun of itself to the point where it was almost mean.
Well, I feel like these are basically archetypes that come from really old school comic books, but old school movies.
Yeah, exactly. More so that. That's a little bit more apparent than the.
Which isn't bad. Like archetypes work, I guess, but they're fairly black and white. You're the jock. You're the nerd. Mm-hmm. You're the school shooter, they're Joker. You're
society,
but there are a lot of like of those things in this movie, and I think that may be why I just felt like this is weird to watch because we're not supposed to be watching like a I don't know like a 1950 detective movie, or something. But
very screwball-y at this point, whenever you're watching it.
Well, let's talk about the characters and the actors. I guess we'll skip over Jessica Alba because there's
I'm sorry.
Andrew's so pissed at her for some reason.
Well, it sucks because like you could tell that the only reason they brought her in was for visual appeal, and you're like, that's pretty rough. Like in today's
Russell, Rachel McAdams, and I think I forgot who else were
Scarlett Johansson
were in the running. Yeah, they're in the running for that part.
All still hot.
Kerry Russell would have been a really, you know, that I'm thinking about it, like she probably would have knocked Sue Storm out of the park.
Jessica Alba met her husband on the set of this film.
Yeah, uh-huh.
The assistant to
Michael
the director.
Michael Chiklis.
No. Oh, God.
Michael Chiklis. Michael Chiklis was on The Shield.
But like only when he's in the Thing outfit.
Yeah, Michael Chiklis.
Daddy needs to get his rocks off.
Where are your ears?
Around the same time, Michael Chiklis was on The Shield, which is a critically acclaimed like FX show, which is like pretty intense.
Like and he went from there.
And then from there to like Fantastic Four, which is kind of crazy.
He cashed in basically.
Yeah, Ian Gruffield, I think that's how you say his last name.
Fantastic.
Mr. Fantastic. You've seen him in a lot of movies. I think I saw him like I first remember watching him in 101 Dalmatians or some shit.
True.
He's British.
He's British.
I loved him as Mr. Fantastic.
I kind of get him confused with the dude who played Charlie's dad in Charlie and the Chocolate Factory.
They kind of have you mean the one from Game of Thrones?
Like yeah, that one also, yeah. Yes, correct.
They kind of have a similar face, but I don't see it. But he's actually, his Mr. Fantastic isn't half bad. It's a little, he plays the scientist more believable than like, you know, than anybody else there. That's what I'm trying to say. Though it's kind of like a very one note and again, old archetype. Old notion of what a scientist is,
because like someone who doesn't know how to he's socially awkward, he doesn't know how to have conversations and hold a relationship because he's just thinking so much.
Yeah.
Well, the second one's dancing really. Dancing really solves that for you.
I remember that because he's telling all these ladies at a club about the Big Bang, and like,
okay. He's like, did you know that?
So tell me if you noticed this, but one of the things he said that he did in the film was he wanted. He wanted Mr. Fantastic to be thinking all the time as a scientist that he would always be jotting notes down constantly, like, you know, formulas, you know, science stuff down. And
observations, hypotheses.
Yeah, I was like, whoa. But I didn't notice that in the movie. Okay, cool. And then the other thing he said was it was hard because he had to fake an American accent. But they would give him, and they would rewrite every day on the set. So they would give him slides of new lines. So sometimes he would just say them, you know, with his English accent.
Not a good sign.
Oh, boy. That's actually something, well, yeah, there's some people that worked on this and worked on Rise of Skywalker, in the writing. Here is a...
Well, Mark Frost apparently did a rewrite of this script, and Mark Frost is the co-creator of Twin Peaks.
Ooh.
That's insane. Like, I don't know where the hell that, I don't know where his contribution went, like, because I was like, there's no, what the hell, like...
And then Chris Evans ended up going on and playing Captain America.
Yeah, let's talk about Chris Evans. Chris Evans
plays the other Human Torch.
Is also in this movie, probably not a big star at the time.
He was Not Another Teen Movie a couple of years earlier.
And this was his first comic book role, right?
Well, wasn't he in
The Losers?
Yeah
but eventually.
That was after.
Yeah. I do. Chris Evans is probably, like, we were talking about earlier how, like, he's the most unlikable person ever in this movie, but, like, right. I don't know if that's a testament to the writing or how good Chris Evans plays douchey.
I think that's
just both.
Yeah, it's probably both. I mean, he's just maybe more so the, yeah, they saw more so the writing, probably, definitely, than the acting.
They saw him in another team, not another team movie, and they're like, you're just that
jock.
Like, yeah, just be that.
That's the jock.
Uh-huh. And you have, rounding out the cast, other than Michael Chiklis is the thing who's, like, underneath a bunch of makeup and prosthetics. You got Julian McMahon, who at the time was at a show called Nip Tuck for FX.
That's who he
Nipple
is.
Tuck.
It's a plastic surgery show.
Oh, I know what Nip Tuck is, John. Check out this body.
he rounds out the cast and plays Victor Von Doom, who eventually turns into the supervillain Doctor Doom.
VVD, Victor Von Doom.
He could have been such a good Doom. I don't blame him.
The look at the end, I was like,
he finally puts on the mask and the cloak.
It's very weird too, because like he doesn't dress like that the entire movie. I was like, hey,
all of a sudden,
yeah.
All of a sudden, he just takes.
Look at this coat that I bought, Gucci.
Well, so this is something that's interesting. You guys say that Chris Evans, you didn't like his Human Torch the whole time, but I on top of him.
You wanted to be on top of him, is what you were going to say.
I see.
Nip Tuck.
Nice.
Dick Suck.
There's also Kerry Washington.
Kerry Washington, I was going to bring her up too.
Lori Holden too. Yeah. She's Ben Grimm's wife.
Oh, she was a
walking.
Bitch.
Oh, shit. I know, what a bitch.
Such oh my bitch. God.
I was like, he's in the thing, like the classic getup. He's in the cast of Get Up, and you fucking shoot his ass down because of how he looks.
So Chris Evans now is my third least favorite because the thing's wife comes out for 5 seconds, then just dips.
She's like, I have a surprise for you. Her. And he's like, hell yeah, I'm about to get my rocks on.
I'm about to get harder.
Yeah, exactly. And then she is like,
ugh. She doesn't even talk to him.
You're ugly.
She gives him
you're
a
one
ring
of those
like,
ugly.
Yeah, like if he cheated on her.
Yeah.
And then she's
even
there
sadder because he can't pick up the ring. He's like, ugh.
That's a joke that happens a lot in this movie with the thing, because he can't pick shit up. Above Chris Evans, the thing's wife, just awful. She very quickly gives up on someone just because, I don't know, they look a little different.
Yeah, the only reason she married him was because... He was hot, I guess.
He's hot?
Which is Michael Chiklis. Yeah, exactly.
That's what I think of when I think of hot.
That's what I'm saying. It's like, what? You know what I'm saying? Like, it makes no sense. Like, he kind of an upgrade.
A lot of things didn't make sense. When he busted out of the hospital, you would think he was in, like, a whole other state of mind. And then he's, like, all calm on the phone. Like,
yeah,
hey,
guess what? I just broke out.
He seems to get, like, dumber as a thing, right? Because, like, his voice changes. I don't know.
Yeah, it gets raspier.
Well, not just that, but it's also, like... he does like bumbling shit. You're just like, wait, what the fuck? Like,
I think it's well, most of it was him discovering his strength because like everything he picked up, he crushed, or like everything he, you know,
oh crap, like, just like stuff like that. You're like,
yeah, wait, yeah, he's like, oh man, like,
just walk out the wall.
Yeah, yeah.
It's like Lenny from Mice and Men. He's killing rabbits by accident. But my number one is Dr. Doom himself. Yeah. He was mean from the beginning.
Yes,
for no, and I don't even still don't understand why he was mean. Is he jealous of anything, or is he just?
They skipped over a central part of his origin, which would have made him that way.
So tell me, from the comic books, why is he bad?
So, like, he was much kind of similar to what they did in the movie. He was a little smart guy. Him, Reed, and Ben Grimm were in school together. And there was this project he was working on, and freaking Grimm sabotaged it, and it exploded, and it ruined his face. And there goes the mask. So he goes around the world. He learns all this magic and all this stuff. He doesn't have any powers. This is all the stuff he learned. So he hates the Fantastic Four for the rest of their existence.
Yeah,
because they're assholes. Because
in the film, I'm just like, do we just hate him because he's rich or because, you know, he's in shadow?
So, and
I'm like, why?
The movie kind of does like a bastardized version of that. Like they're all people that used to go to school.
They know each other.
They're just rivals.
It's like, to me, I thought this movie felt convoluted because you start. Like, and you hit the ground running. Yeah. Like, it's already a statue of Dr. Doom.
Meeting.
Like, you have to know who the Fantastic Four are to even try to enjoy this movie at least a little bit. Because and then you're like, you know, Dr. Doom statue right from the first shot. Yeah. He's like, oh, he had a statue built and blah, blah, blah. Like, okay, these two are friends, obviously. Like,
he likes himself.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Yeah. And, like, the metal stuff. And you're like, oh, I get it. It's foreshadowing and shit like that.
He's confident.
But, again, if you don't know, you're like, what the fuck is going on? Like, instantly, like, who the fuck is Dr. Doom?
So,
like,
his face is scarred. He thinks he's ugly. And, like, he's still, like, very, he's still very good looking. Like, he's just like, man, John, look at my fucking face.
Hot.
I just think that it's hilarious when people think that. He's just like, look, I'm fucking hideous. And you're just like, wait, what? And you just got like a scratch.
He's got a little.
Yeah.
So Susan Storm. Storm? Is that her last name?
Storm, yeah.
Storm, yeah.
So in the comic books, does she have a relationship
to
with...
Storm? I'm just
kidding. To Storm?
I thought that's what you were going to say.
Oh, are they sisters?
No.
Oh, maybe?
One's a superhero with a moniker. The other one's her actual name.
Let me write this idea for another spec porn.
Jesus
but
Christ.
So, but does she have a relationship with Dr. Doom in the comic books? Because that felt a little shoehorned in this movie because he's also mean to her a lot.
Yeah, right. He's like, I'm going to propose to you, baby, in front of the world. And then he's like, close the shield.
Then I'm going to kill her.
Yeah. Quick, close the shield.
But is that something that, because I like that. I guess that's a cool idea to have tension and jealousy, but I don't know.
More was like Namor.
Yeah.
Like, okay. Namor's always tempting her. Like,
but she's faithful because Reed can stretch his dick.
Yeah, exactly.
Why would you leave someone who can have any size?
He can turn his penis into a knife. That's something.
He just turned it into another version of himself.
I know.
So it just fucking blows her up from the inside.
But she doesn't really have much to pick with. The hottest guy is her brother.
That's so, yeah.
It's very true. Yeah, hold on, the thing's ugly.
Idea for another spec.
Oh, no.
Oh my gosh.
All right, here's what we're gonna do. I'm gonna let my boner die down. And we're gonna take a break, then we're gonna play a game, and we're gonna come back, and we're gonna talk more about Fantastic Four.
Skin.
So, I don't know if I'm gonna edit a lot. I don't know yet.
What's the game?
All right, welcome back from that break. I hope you purchase whatever it is that I talked about. We're playing a game. It is a fun game. We talked about the tropes that happen a lot in Fantastic Four. And in this game, we are going to see just how well and how much of it you noticed while watching the film. Here's how the game works. I'm going to read a common trope that not only just happens in superhero films, it happens in a lot of movies. And your job is, if you buzz in, tell me what moment in Fantastic Four or what character exhibited that.
What moment or?
Yeah, or what character. Like, if you can just, if you just know what it is. So, for example, I say, you know, at some point in this movie, somebody, I don't know, does finger guns at a cop, and you know who it is in the movie.
Okay.
Cool.
I get you.
All right? Yeah. But all of these are... tropes, baby. Tropes. These are things that we see a lot.
Tropics.
The loser. There will be two losers of this game. And those two losers.
Half of us.
I'll just tell you what they have to do. They have to reenact the ending proposal. in Fantastic Four.
Are you going to give us the script? I don't remember.
Yeah, I have the script. Okay, no, cool. You guys should be off book by now. We've been rehearsing.
I think I want to lose. I need the affection.
I want to be sued.
All right, let's just not play the game. It sounds like we got two. We just casted. Okay, cool. All right, here we go. So I'm going to unlock your... things. Here's a trope that happens.
Oh, okay, we did it already. My bad. I was trying to.
It's reset.
Okay, cool.
Here's a trope that happens in Fantastic Four. A character touches a photo of their family. John, you got in first. Who did that? Jay Money.
Okay.
That's Moaning. Ben Grimm.
Damn
the thing. Yeah, that happens in this movie. And something else that happens is when they find, they ask themselves, like, where did he go? Mr. Fantastic looks at the ground and the photo is there. And he's like, that's where he went.
Oh, yeah. Jeez. Shit. Yeah. Damn, when you put it... God damn, this movie's dumb.
All right, here we go. Here's something that happens in this movie. Who does it happen to? A character is introduced by explaining what their job is and their role in the company. Senor Fantastico, who's that?
It's me.
Okay. It's Mr. Fantastic.
Say it again.
Mr. Fantastic.
Not that.
No, a character is introduced by their job title and what they do at the company.
Sue Storm?
Yes. Here's the line that Dr. Doom says like 2 minutes in the movie. He says, if it isn't my new director of genetics, Susan Storm.
And you know what's funny is that they all know who she is, and yeah, he still says her name.
I know.
He's all, just so that he looks at the audience and is like, hey, this is one out of four.
That's true. They all have a long history with her.
And he's like, look, it's her.
That's how I'm going to introduce you guys now. Hey, it's my... virginity taker.
Virginity. Virgin infinity taker.
Fucking fuck that shit up. All right, here we go. Here's something that happens in this movie. Someone gives an ETA and a countdown for something. Senor Fantastico.
Someone says an ETA or gives a what?
Or countdown to something that's going to happen.
He's buying time.
No, I'm not. It's the Human Torch.
No.
I know.
Oh,
I got it.
John was next on the buzz.
Fuck. Who the fuck does that?
I got it.
Dr. Doom.
No. It's Mr. Fantastic.
Yes.
The storm.
Yes.
It comes in, like, he said, we have 7 minutes before it hits.
And
it
happens. I thought you meant, like, someone was counting down, like, 5, 4.
No, like he's like, I have all the calculations.
Yeah.
Oh, I know fuck. I'm not keeping track.
It's all right. It's 1-1-1. John, the one without the H, is the only one that doesn't have a point.
Right. I feel shit for you,
John.
Just so everyone knows what I'm having a slow stroke. Jay Money is John.
Don't say that.
Idea for another fan. The long stroke. A self portrait.
A self portrait. Yeah. Now you're just painting what you did.
The long stroke, a self-portrait of me playing golf. You sickos. You sick fucks. Okay, here we go. Chris Evans saluting. Oh shit.
he just said
I fucked that one up too. No.
The Human Torch.
I was gonna say someone saluting like the Captain America. Chris Evans does that. Oh my fuck. All right, here we go. Someone looking at a map and saying, that can't be right. Andrew?
Mr. Fantastic.
Yes, he says that. That happens a lot in other movies, too. Wait, this can't be right. I say that a lot when we're recording the podcast and I forget to press record.
Wait.
I'm like, wait a minute. Wait, fuck. This can't be right. We've been recording for 0 minutes? Yeah. That's not even a joke.
Yeah,
that is.
Yeah, stop laughing.
True.
Because it's happening.
Yeah. Here's the next one. Someone saying, trouble is my middle name. John without the H. Oh, wait. No, wait. Yeah, it's John with the H. Who said it first?
Wait. Sorry. Wait, he has an H.
Sorry. John, who says that?
What was it again? Sorry.
He says.
You see it?
No, I'm not going to say it again. Fuck it.
Trouble is my middle name.
Oh, nice. That's okay. I did
this. Who said
Johnny
that?
Storm.
Huh?
Johnny Storm. Human Torch.
Yeah. Human Torch says that. Who else would say that?
Who's that one? Which one out of the four is that one? Which powers is that one?
Johnny Storm, no. The answer is no.
Human Torch said that. Is it rock, stretch, invisible? It's funny because at first I was like, who else would say that? But I could see anyone else saying that movie. Yeah. Dr. Doom could say, trouble is my
middle I had to think
name.
About it. You know, like that sounds like a very Doom-ish very line.
Yeah, it
I
really does.
Kerry Washington.
She's, that's a good scene. Here we go. Oh, no. I don't have... Oh, yeah. In what scene does a song from Sum 41 play for a long time? The Thing! That's Roy.
The Thing. It's
I don't know what happened.
The Human Torch when he's surfing. I mean, surfing.
Nope. Snowboarding. He was not surfing. Roy, I'll give it to you. Fuck it.
Yeah, give me the game code again.
Right here. And it was also Velvet Revolver when he's kissing that girl.
Wow. The soundtrack of this movie has straight up bangers, baby.
It does.
But yeah. Well,
I need to sign back in. I had that scene. Like I pushed it before Roy, but
I don't believe you.
I keep pushing the button and it keeps like trying to save the image.
So when mine did like the 3D click and so it took me to a image of the buzzer.
No excuses,
Andrew. What a weird brag from Andrew to say he has a phone that has 3D touch.
Huh. Oh yeah.
Weird.
Sorry.
Here we go. This happens in this movie. What scene is this? New Yorkers clapping for a hero. I don't even know how to say this. Penis. It's John without the H.
That was right.
Do you want to show? Oh, you can't see. He has an 8, a lot of equal signs, and then a D. There's actually 4 equal signs.
Yes.
I don't know if he's alluding to my Fantastic Four feature film. Feature film? 2-minute film.
Feature film.
But what scene do New Yorkers clap for a hero?
He's a hero. The Thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's the yeah. He didn't even say. He didn't even say. Okay.
The bridge scene.
He's on the bridge.
Okay. Okay, I was about to take that from you.
I know. Here's what I'll say about that scene. It took them 5 weeks to film the bridge scene.
Oh Jesus!
And watching it, I think to myself,
it wasn't worth it.
Well, they're solving a problem that they created.
Yeah. Well, and also they make Jessica Alba strip down, and they're like, all right, cool. The Invisible Woman lead the way.
Yes,
and
that's so
like,
weird.
No, I like that because they were like, you're the only one who can get through, and she does, and then they're right next to her like there. And I'm like, so she didn't have to get
literally
naked.
All you had to do was say excuse me and they would have let you through.
What did you do?
We just wanted to see Jessica Alba's bot.
That's crazy. Yep.
That scene is actually the most, even though they caused it, that's kind of like a very Fantastic Four-esque scene, like where they're all
if they had caused it.
It
would have been cool.
It's one of the only Fantastic Four scenes we get.
Yeah, exactly.
2 hours like, long and a 10-minute thing at the end.
Yeah, other than the fight at the very end. The fight at the very end is kind of very Fantastic Four-like.
If you think about that scene, it starts with, I don't know, the Thing not contemplating suicide, but then saving someone from committing suicide, putting that person in danger, almost killing him, which is what he wanted.
Did he
saving him from getting killed and throwing a propane tank? It's a crazy scene.
He stops a trailer because the trailer's about to hit something, but it looks like he killed the driver of that trailer. Like,
he saves him.
Yeah, I know. Yeah, he takes him out of the seat. But
oh my god!
But also, that was a really cool action sequence for the Thing.
Yeah,
I was like, this is a really cool. Like, it just kind of showed you what he's capable.
Like, he just turns ground.
Yeah.
Really all right, cool.
Here's something else that happens in the movie. Someone looking at bills that say overdue on them. Only one person can really be doing this in the movie, but Señor Fantástico, who was it?
Señor Fantástico, Mr. Fantastic.
Yes. I feel like this is pretty late in the movie, but when they finally get to the Baxter building, like what, 45 minutes into the movie?
That's totally true. Yeah, I didn't notice that they came so late.
He's looking, he got mail from his doorman,
Stanley,
that he can afford. And the postman,
the mailman.
Lumpkins or Willie something.
Yeah.
Yeah, Willie.
But it's just bills that say overdue on the front. There's a lot of them. Does he own that building? What's the deal?
Apparently not, because he's paying bills.
Yeah, so I was wondering, does he own this place? Because he looks rich.
They're about to foreclose on his ass for sure.
The trouble of...
take that shit away.
Yeah. Here's a... let me see.
That's it. I won.
One more. Someone looks through a yearbook in this to signify the past. Dick, you got it first.
It's Susan.
Yes, it's Susan. That's a nice line. Who is it?
It is.
It's Susan. All right, this is going to be insane.
She's contemplating cheating on her boyfriend with the old Reed.
This is insane. There is a 4-way tie.
No, there's not.
Yeah, there is.
Nice. Bro.
Because John without the H... took the last two, there's a 4-way tie. Everyone has.
I would thought I was ahead of everybody, to be honest. No,
and now we can all marry.
I don't have
each
two. I have three.
Oh, do you really?
Yes.
All right. Well, yeah. Andrew has proven himself the winner.
I did have three.
Congratulations,
I swear.
Andrew.
Bro, this is on. Like, we can literally listen back. Listen back.
Play no,
back.
No, 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 no. Here's what we'll do. Because you guys are guests, you guys will lose. It's only fair. Okay. So I'm going to hand you guys the proposal.
Yes.
And it's highlighted the lines that you're going to read.
I want to be the proposal.
Do you remember when you had to sing that thing for the Star Wars thing? I always laugh on the daily about it.
Yeah, this so isn't funny. That bad.
Yeah.
But here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to read the directions.
Screen directions.
The screen, directions.
Yes, it's so cheesy.
Hey, you got to look into each other's eyes. Yeah. You have to kiss.
You want a real kiss?
but they can't see this.
Okay, ready? Here we go. I'm going to start reading it. Exterior, circle line boat.
Who?
Huh?
Yeah. I'm Sue.
It should be highlighted. It should be highlighted.
Oh, fuck. Okay, cool. I fucked it up. All right, okay.
You guys just want to be Sue because you want to look at yourself in the mirror.
I just want someone to love me.
All right, here we go. Exterior, circle line boat, deck. Andrew, I swear to God, if you touch my shit one more time, I swear to God, I'm going to force you to be in my next spec. If you touch it one more time, you won't even know that you're in the next video that I post.
I'm just kidding.
Cosby. Exterior, circle line boat, deck, dusk. A romantic view of the cityscape. Oh, God. Reed stands with Sue.
I found a broken gasket from space.
A gasket? Reed, we're at a party.
He opens his hand, revealing a circular piece of metal. What the fuck? Just about the size of a ring. Sue slows down.
If one of us were to wear it.
She sees Johnny and Ben inside watching. They're in on the secret. Reed looks her square in the eye, unflinching.
Wait, is this Sue? Oh.
Reed. What are you doing?
Reed drops to his knees. His head stays eye level while his body drops. Sue gapes, so emotional, she starts to disappear.
No more thinking. No more variables. Sue Storm, will you?
She's gone.
Sue? Sue? You there?
Dead silence. And then the ring disappears. Sue is wearing it.
Yes!
Reed goes to kiss her.
That's my nose, genius. These are my lips.
Reed goes down. The partygoers watch from outside the window, wondering why a grown man is licking the side of a boat. Reed picks an invisible pube from his mouth. It's just part of the game, baby.
Oh my gosh.
It's not possible, but the thing is harder than he has ever been.
He is now turned to steel.
Human Torch starts to jack off, not knowing it's his sister. Well, guys, we'll be right back. You guys have a good time out there. We'll be right back.
Yeah.
He had like Sith powers. I don't know what the fuck was going on.
Let me get back from the break. Hold on. Welcome back. You might have caught some of that. It was really good stuff, but we weren't recording. We're going to talk more about Fantastic Four. And you guys were talking about Doom a little bit.
Doom.
And I will. I mean, it doesn't
Call
matter.
Doom.
This shouldn't shade your idea of it. But there were quite a few people who weren't happy with Dr. Doom's character. And I don't know if this is true, but I read that even Stan Lee, who generally doesn't give input or he doesn't like to negatively critique things, he agreed with some of the criticism of Dr. Doom, which is rare for Stan Lee to talk about. But what did you guys think about the character now that I told you that the creator didn't like it?
I don't know, he obviously played him over, like Julian McMahon obviously played him over the top. You know, he obviously is like an evil boss type of guy, douchey dude. Like, I was just kind of confused on what his powers were. Like, he's made of metal. Like, I know in the comics, he basically just is a suit of armor.
Yeah, that's what I hated.
And, like, he...
And you know what's weird is that there's a scene
where... He has electric powers or some shit?
There's a scene where he's, like, shocking people, and he uses it to, like, power this machine to, like, depower the thing or whatever to recreate the little cosmic storm. But, and then he shoots Reed Richards, who's rubber, right? But doesn't electricity not... Like, rubber doesn't conduct electricity. No, well, and then that guy superheated. I'm like, so it's not electricity. It's heat? Is it just energy?
What is his power in the comic book?
He doesn't have it.
Oh.
Magic. He's magic.
He knows.
He's just like a Doctor Strange.
He's like an anti-Doctor Strange.
Yeah, like he's knows like, magic, let me science.
Make, yeah, let me make these like Iron Man gauntlets that shoot like repulsor blasts or like shit like that, you know?
It's like a fucking angry Batman or something.
Yeah,
exactly. That's interesting.
Yeah, and then this one, they kind of simplify it by, like, he's the...
the Tin Man.
It's a stupid metal Sith.
You know what? Yeah, he's the same... He's affected by the same... Oh, sorry.
I want to talk about a scene that Andrew just brought up where he uses that machine to depower the thing using his power. But when everyone's in trouble, the thing uses it. And all of a sudden, that machine has enough power.
Works fine now.
Yeah, it's just like, oh, shit, well, I guess they didn't need... Doctor Doom.
I like how he turns back into the thing very perfectly. Oh, like, it's not like he's going to turn like into something on? Different. Yeah, like
it's just like he has to get. You see him start getting naked. Like he's just trying to turn invisible.
That is an interesting thing because Doctor Doom.
An interesting what
thing?
Nice. Oh,
nice.
Dick suck. but I think Doctor Doom is an interesting character because you're right. I didn't know that none of these powers were actually part of his lore. Because a lot of the things that I forgave in the movie...
A lot of the what?
Lore?
A lot of the...
Things. Okay. All right. I'm going to stop saying that.
Thing?
Oh, my God. You got me again. But I thought that those were the moments that I forgave because I thought they just had to do that. And now I'm learning that they didn't. So that's interesting. Because controlling metal, we've seen already because X-Men had just come out.
Right, yeah.
Lightning, we've seen because of the Emperor, who is not dead, by the way. And so it I don't know. Yeah. I don't, it is weird.
It's a weird.
I don't know what his power is. You're right.
That's again, like they just kind of like they simplify it. I mean, he's a part of the same. He was a part of the same experiment, like in this movie, like that created the Fantastic Four.
He was the shields that were metal that were supposed to protect me. Oh, it phased through.
Did you notice that all of the things that are titanium?
All of the what?
All of the stuff that is. Now I'm going to talk really slow so I don't say that word. But all of the stuff that is made out of metal are labeled titanium. Yeah. Watch the movie again. And really? They say titanium on them. And I noticed that towards the end, I was like, wait a minute. Just to show what they're made out of. Like, it's the weirdest thing. I was like, is that a company logo? Hey, but no, it's just...
People need to know.
Yeah, it's very weird because like, I feel like Dr. Doom's powers are the only ones that make sense at the beginning. Because like, oh, I was behind metal and the race passed through the metal. Whoa, got me. But everybody else, they're just like, fire. water.
Random.
Yeah, well, I like fire, that scene where the storm hits him and you can kind of tell...
Yeah.
Like green stretches.
But that's what I thought was weird. Is like it felt like fucking random. And so you're right. Was, when like the thing random. Turns into the thing again, like so perfectly. It's just what? Like, yeah.
Exactly. you got.
But bitch. I said the thing.
What?
Let's not do that. Yeah. Because I'm really going to be scared. No. It's hard for me not to say that word.
And also, I think I like. Because the look of Dr. Doom technically looks cool.
Yeah, once
like,
he put on the mask and the cloak, he looked fucking bad.
I don't know.
But then the cloak came down and I was like, oh, fuck. Like, he's just bald.
He's also, like, wearing, like, some sort of weird suit and shit, like, underneath it. And it's kind of, like, it's a little weird.
He's really self-conscious.
His like, actual Dr. Like Doom attire from Rise of the Silver Surfer looks a little better.
That's a big part of this is he doesn't die and he is... I feels like he's being set up to be the main villain
in another movie. Well,
like at the ending, what happens when they ship him back to like Liberia?
That's exactly what happened.
Okay, I was when I was younger, I thought they were sending him to jail.
To be honest, when I was younger, I couldn't read, and so I was like, I'm not gonna read that shit. Like that just says like Japan or something.
You left him on a boat.
You had no idea the metal was titanium.
Yeah, for sure.
I do like the Latveria references because you know Dr. Doom is the like the. What is he like?
He overthrew the Latverian government and he took it over.
Himself.
That all the Latveria references just reminded me of a Doctor Doom that actually would have been.
Yeah, good. Like
it reminded me of the real Doctor Doom.
Well, yeah, and it's interesting. I don't know.
It's hinted that he comes from Liberia. Obviously, yeah. Someone says that, but like, because like, I think at one point there's like a board member is like, you can go back to the old country or something that, and like, it's a little weird. Yeah, but whatever.
Like, damn, it's real like super anti-immigrant.
What characters work best for you guys? I know that we're talking about how and maybe this is why it doesn't translate as well is, but I don't know. There's Avengers movies with a million characters.
Yeah, and I think
there's four main characters, and if you throw in Doom, there's five. And so sometimes it means that you're not spending as much time with others as you would, you know, the ones you want to focus on.
X-Men had that problem too.
Which of the four main characters do you think work the best
visually, like,
no, not visually, just in general? Like, overall as a character.
I like Mr. Fantastic because one of my favorite powers is stretching powers, so like, and I Mr. Fantastic is my number two hero. So I like, for me, the whole movie, I'm just trying to redeem him. I'm like, okay, he's doing okay, you know, he's doing all right, you know, like,
we got Stockholm syndrome.
Yeah. No, but I love Mr. Fantastic, and I think the actor did a good job.
Yeah, I think the thing that works for me is it's not the thing.
Oh my god!
I would say it's like because Ben Grimm's like practical like makeup like that actually does work. Like I'd rather have stuff like that than the the fan four stick, you know, the Josh Trank version, which is just all CG. Like, that's a little terrifying. Weird to look at. Yeah, and it's a little bit more like,
you're like, oh fuck.
I wish I had a bigger brow. Like,
but I think I like that practical effect. That being said, I think the best character that works for me, no, I'm gonna go ahead and say Ben Grimm. I was gonna say the Human Torch, but like, the Human Torch works visually, but again, like, I don't think the I think the personality of that character in this version is a little much.
You know, like, I'll say that what I remember as a kid and that stayed watching this movie just earlier today is the thing. You're not going to say anything now?
No, I'm not going to say any what?
Okay, you got me. But the empathy and I was just so sympathetic towards the thing, even when I was a kid and not understanding all of the other themes other than, you know, how Chris Evans could get any girl that he wanted. Oh man. But the thing's role and his storyline, and I know how insane and soap opera and melodramatic it is to see his wife throwing a wedding ring down on the ground. But I liked him.
Yeah, and I think the character, like I said, kind of works, like, out of anybody else. I think no offense to the, you know, to the Mr. Fantastic, but I think the stretching powers, you can only do so much because it has to be obviously like fully CG. And it's hard to do like a really satisfying, like in comics it looks really cool because you can go, you know, crazy with the concept, but like in movies
it's a little goofy in a
Yeah, exactly. And so like, it's just, I don't know how you, the coolest thing I saw that Fantastic or Mr. Fantastic did in the movie is when he turns into a blanket around like Dr. Doom. Like, that's actually a very fantastic thing to do, like or Mr. Fantastic.
True to him between the thing when even, he's like stretched all over him.
Like, it was a kind of like a full Nelson, but like a million times.
Cool, John, who is your favorite character in this?
Talked to John. Oh.
I guess I would also have to say the thing. I wanted to say, like, part of me wants to say Mr. Fantastic, but I can't because there's such an essential part of his character missing, and that's like the confidence. Like, they took it all away from him, and then they made him this meek loser who can't even fight for his woman. And I was like, that's not Mr. Fantastic at all.
He was cuckolded at the beginning.
We went an hour until we said cuck.
He is missing the confidence.
That's one of the most important parts about Reed Richards, because like, even in the comics, it's not always about fucking stupid stretching.
The flaw in this movie for Mr. Fantastic is that he works too much, or that he's too focused, which, if you think about it, isn't really bad. Like, you're like, oh, good for you.
No, it's not.
You know, like, you work really hard at your science. Cool. But in the film, they make it seem like that is something that he needs to not do. There was even a point where the Invisible Girl says, you know, Reed, he thinks about everything before he does one thing or something like
Johnny Storm's like, don't think, just do, or something like that.
It was just like, but then in my head I was like, wow, you should think about what you're doing, especially when you're talking about people's lives, bro.
Thinking is stupid. Stop thinking.
Turn that part off, baby. But yeah, I get what you're saying. Like, I think, I didn't say thing. I think. Yeah. No, but I think maybe they just took it as like, we want him to end the movie confident, so we have to start him not. But it's such a weird trajectory that isn't new or, I don't know, too exciting. Mm-hmm. Andrew, what was your favorite thing?
I thought it was weird because I thought we were gonna all gonna have to choose different ones, or we were all gonna feel forced to choose different characters since there's four of us. But I also agree with them. It's the thing for me. It's because, like, I think he should be played like that even in, like, a newer version. Because that's basically it. Like, because he is kind of, like, not the smartest one. And he is the muscle. And he is, you know.
Mopey and stuff.
He was in the fucking trench coat and the hat. Yeah. All he needed was a fucking fat-ass cigar.
They hinted that he smoked.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, for sure. Like, yeah, he was like, I used to smoke a lot or whatever.
But, like, in the comics, he always has, like, a big.
Yeah, fucking. And so, like, he then looked, like, jumped, like, straight off the page. And he wasn't that big to the point where it was like cartoony, but it was a good enough size to still have a really satisfying kind of throwdown with Doom at the end, because it is primarily with the
when they fall off the building,
they go through the pool and stuff, and
that scene was cool
and things like that. And so I think that's, again, one of those characters that I think should kind of always be played the same, really. It's just a meathead, you know.
Yeah. Like Scooby-Doo.
Yeah.
There's a really cool part where the thing throws a car at Dr. Doom, and that's actually really cool.
Yeah, the, like, transmission sticks.
Yeah. This damn one-liner is just like, pull over, like stuff like that at the very end.
Yeah, and
this is going to be fun before he Dr. Doom starts to grunt.
Yeah. He starts to, like, moan.
Some of it is, I think, clever for the time. I think there's a part in the beginning when Dr. Doom proposes to Storm. He says these four words that'll change your life. And right before he says, "Will you marry me?" Mr. Fantastic says, "Oh shit, I wrote it. Oh, the cloud is escalating," which is four words, and it does change their lives. Like, it's such a, and I feel like when they were writing it, they were like winking at each other and being like,
"Damn, we're smart as fuck. We're
gonna get it today, bro." So it is kind of crazy to think about how subtle movies are now.
I also thought
where that doesn't happen that much.
Speaking of that scene, it kind of freaked me out that he was like, "Hey, you're about to get the biggest raise of your life, like a promotion. Marry me." I'm like, what the fuck kind of, like,
there is
kind of weird ass shit's going on here. Like, super, like, nepotism. And
you talked earlier about Human Torch.
Marry me and you could be the
me too.
There's a whole lot of things here that would not stand in 2020.
Nope.
Not here. We are all allies. All of us.
Not up in here.
Yeah. Yes. Cool. Anything else? I mean, we talked about kind of the writing and the I guess the characters and the dialogue. Big things.
The score is kind of forgettable.
Yeah. The what?
The score. There is something cool that, like, each character seemed to have their own respective themes. So but it does get annoying, especially at the very end, because, like, every time a power jumps on screen, you hear, like, the chord or whatever the
fuck. It's not even a song, because
you hear, like, Invisible Woman's, like, little trill. Like, it's like a sound that trills every time the force shield comes up, and it gets a little much by the very end. You're just like, okay, that's pretty dumb.
I gotta ask you about the Invisible Woman. Is it part of her, because in the film, they made it seem like when she
can make force fields?
She becomes invisible because she feels invisible. Or when there's something emotional happening,
they're doing like that.
It's
women
connected,
thing,
yeah, to her feelings. Is that something that happens in the comic books?
I want to say no, but I also remember the era where she was created, and I'm sure someone thought women emotions. You know,
yeah, it's gotta go. There's a whole totally line true, about it too, where it's like, maybe if you can control your emotions, you could.
Yeah.
Like, damn, sexist.
Yeah, I think that happens also too in the second one. Like, they carry that thread over to the rise of the Silver Surfer.
It's an easy thing to I guess connect it to, is like, oh, if you feel like no one can see you.
Yeah, and that's also like a very movie tropish thing too, like Ghost Rider, you know, his whenever he feels something, like, his flame turns blue, like in that movie and stuff. So it's kind of like, you know, it's like, what do the emotions have an effect on your respective power? And it's and this one, it just happens to be, like, you know, her main power. Like,
well,
she gets emotional. She gets see-through.
You know, we talk about how this movie seems really, really dated. But and I think even at the time it was. Critics didn't love this movie
at all. Yeah.
But audiences went. It made three times the budget to the point of where it was, you know, they made more.
Because it was because of our lack of options in superhero movies, maybe.
Yeah, and then, like, it was they were on the rise. I think, like, Spider-Man had just come out. three years before this.
Yeah.
Batman Begins, which is hard to believe, was that same year.
Came out the same year. And so did Elektra.
Elektra, yeah. Well, still very Fox era version of, like, you know, very pre-MCU version of superheroes where, like, again, it's still, because everything that wasn't Spider-Man or X-Men, it's still very, like, cartoony. Like,
they were risks, no matter what. If they weren't Spider-Man or X-Men.
Right, yeah. Because, like, I just brought up Ghost Rider. You watch that movie now, and, like, it's exactly what... Like, it's someone coming in thinking, like, these are what superheroes are supposed to be. Like, yeah. Very big, over-the-top things, and, like, you know, and you don't get that anymore. Now you kind of take them seriously. Like, now you take the superheroes very seriously.
Here are, so, well, we'll go to 2005, because this will kind of help gauge the response, but number one grossing movie of the year was Harry Potter and the Goblet of Fire. Star Wars Episode III, Revenge of the Sith came out that year. The Chronicles of Narnia, Lion, Witch, and Wardrobe. War of the Worlds, which we talked about, John, earlier this week, came out that year too.
Ooh, I love that movie.
Peter Jackson's King Kong, Madagascar, Mr. and Mrs. Smith, oh no, R.I.P. Brangelina, Charlie and the Chocolate Factory, Batman Begins, and Hitch, a comedy, was in the top 10.
Hitch!
So best actor that year was Philip Seymour Hoffman for Capote. Walk the Line came out that year, and this was the year that Crash beat Brokeback Mountain, and Crash wasn't as good as Brokeback Mountain.
I
remember that.
And
so I wish I knew how to quit you.
Yeah, Ang Lee won the
best directing, too. Right?
Yeah. No. Yeah. But yeah, that's the kind of year that it was. So there were a lot of really good, different things.
Even Fantastic Four. Now, when you put it that way, Fantastic Four seemed dated even back then.
Yeah.
Like, it seemed like it was something out of the 90s. I mean, we still get these types of superhero movies. Like, I mean, has anyone seen Venom? Like, you know, it's the same type of. You know, that the tone is still like very, like, it doesn't feel like an MCU movie.
Yeah.
So like it, you still get like movies like that nowadays. They're just like, you know, it's just something outside of the MCU or outside of the because DC kind of does the same thing too. Like Shazam is a very playful movie.
And it's weird to think about, but
so is Aquaman. Fucking hell, Aquaman's like goofy as fuck.
2005 was 16 years ago. So if you were born that year, you can drive a car.
2005 was 15 years ago.
I'm what? Wait, what?
We're right. 2020.
It is 15 years ago.
I was like, we're not in 2021.
Oh my god! Then that means. Wait a minute.
I gotta go fix.
What's the?
Don't do it.
Okay, I won't do that joke. Well, let's go around the horn and give our final thoughts on Fantastic Four. We'll start with Andrew. Andrew.
THOTS.
Thoughts.
Yeah. So I liked it as a kid. It had the flash and flare. It had everything a growing boy needed. In a movie.
You say a growing boy or a groin boy?
Both.
A groin boy. Hot.
But now, yeah, it sucks. That's it. I mean, to be honest, it's still better than the Josh Trank one. I like the Josh Trank one all the way up until they get their powers, and then it fucking sucks. But this one...
Yeah, that's a weird movie.
This one's super campy. I think it's definitely a byproduct of its time. You know, cue the Sum 41 scene doing extreme sports to that thing. Like, Johnny Storm doing a fucking backflip, and I was like, that wasn't him. That was a stunt double. yeah, it's very dated, but there are some things that I can look at and be like, that's a cool part. That's a cool thing.
Thing.
John Carpenter. Yeah, it would be really, you know, again, some cool parts that shine through. But overall, I mean, you can skip this forever. Like, see, I don't even know what to say about it. Like, that was the thing. It's like, it kind of baffled me when I was sitting there. Because, again, I knew it was bad.
Tim Story has better movies, too. I mean, you can watch Barbershop.
Sure. Yeah, that's exactly. A great movie. Damn, Barbershop, classic. But it's unfortunate that these companies can't seem to get it right with this one. And I've obviously, this is kind of where it started because, again, the other one that was made was meant to just be made to keep the rights. But it sucks that we haven't had a win yet with this family. And I'm sure the MCU is planning something crazy and eventually, and I'm sure they'll do it right or they'll get their own show or whatever it needs to be. But hopefully these concepts have evolved.
I don't know. It's so weird because I think the Fantastic, maybe John, you'll probably like maybe challenge this but also because I don't really read a whole lot of Fantastic Four comics, but like, or even recently too, like the whole Fantastic Four idea seems kind of like dated.
No,
like, you know,
no,
You think so?
No, families don't get deep. Yeah. Families will exist for the rest of eternity.
Like, I'm talking about like the way, like,
you're talking about the archetypes.
Yeah, I guess the way it's being portrayed on screen, only because, like, you know, they really tried to go in a different direction with Josh Trank's version. And while still kind of trying to keep that, because that familial dynamic, like that family thing, is at the core of what the Fantastic Four is.
I feel like the next evolution of the family thing is to add their kids, because then now you've got the mixed house. This is a more modern thing. You got an uncle who lives with you. Mm-hmm. And, you know, you got two uncles who live with you.
And
you
that
know,
would
they
be,
might be gay, I guess. I don't know.
That'd be really cool. I'm trying to imagine this.
Hold on. Idea for another fan.
I'm just trying to imagine this in the context of the MCU. Maybe I'm overthinking it. Like, when they come out, it's just going to be the Fantastic Four. Like, you're
all these characters deserve solo movies before getting their team up. Four. It should be called the Fantastic One.
But I do like two. This movie is actually still very fun. As much as like shit we've talked about it and stuff like that. It's goofy as hell. It's not maybe fun in a like in. It's in a weird way. Like, it's not so
it's
much
like a roll your eyes.
Goof. Yeah, like you're laughing at it more so than like with it. Obviously, and I still think, like, you know, I think this one and the Rise of the Silver Surfer, I think I might prefer Rise of the Silver Surfer a little bit better. Ooh. Just a little bit better, only because I like the Silver Surfer as a character. Because
Johnny Storm turns into Super Skrull at the end.
Oh, yeah, I forgot about that shit. He does. Yeah, and then obviously it's Miles. I don't know why it would be Miles, but it's better than the Josh Trank version, only because that one botches really hard at one point. But I think it's still, like, it's a very fun, like, you know, pre-MCU movie. It's just a very fun pre-MCU movie. It's like the way I had fun with The Punisher, like the Thomas Jane version. Like,
a lot of substance.
Yeah, there's not a whole lot of stuff there, but it's got moments, and you're just like, eh, that was all right. Like, you know, it's not something that you would obviously, like, you know, obviously, superhero movies now have come a long way since then. But it's still, yeah, like, it's, you know, I probably would prefer watching this over Ghost Rider, probably.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. That was the choice.
Yeah, you gave me the choice. I was like, oh, yeah, that's for
a little. We were going to do Ghost Rider eventually. But
you guys missed out on me entering on my sweet Harley, baby.
Your chopper.
Doing a wheelie.
Yeah, I mean, I
Birds of Prey.
Fantastic Four 2005 was all right. It was all right.
Yeah, it was an okay year.
It was okay. Yeah, that's the only thing I can really say about it. See, I can't. I don't want to bash it a lot. I also don't want to praise it. So it's just like it's just right there.
Well, Roy, what did you think of Fantastic Four? I was about to say Fantastic Mr. Fox.
it's that forgettable. You're forgetting.
I still love it. I think a lot of the scenes are great. Like, if you take out like the fight scenes, the action scenes are great. Like, when it's Thing and Mr. Fantastic fighting, I think it's really cool. When it's the Thing and Dr. Doom fighting, falling off the building into the pool, it's awesome. You know, the fight at the end. But then you get into a dialogue, and that's what kind of ruins the movie. It's just the cheesiness of it. But, I mean, everything else is just really, really good. Like, and that's what I like. But, I mean, like, it's something there that, as a big Fantastic Four fan, I was like, I want to love this. I need to love this. But, you know, like, the cheesiness just kind of takes it away. But I mean, I still love it, knowing that it's really flawed.
I get it. I mean, because I get the loyalty to a brand that, like, you kind of need to like mm-hmm. it, so I understand that part. So
that's how I feel about my dad.
Well, you're next, John.
Why don't we explore that further?
It all started when I was 5.
I just need to love him. I need him to love me.
My dad's dead, so I guess he's like
Jesus Christ. We're spiraling.
What?
Bring it back.
You know, I just, in my head, nobody dies in this movie now that I'm thinking about it. I was going to say, my dad's dead, like, .. But Dr. Doom survived.
Someone did die. The guy at on the board. Remember, Dr. Doom's like, no personal
feelings.
That's
true. He got blasted. Zaps it, like, through.
He
kills his doctor.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that too. Yeah.
My dad's like that doctor. Except he would never go to medical school.
I didn't like the movie the second watch as an adult. I didn't like the movie at all. I tried to find good things about it. And like I said earlier, there's something there. I mean, maybe just a family dynamic. Which John called archaic earlier. But like I said, families don't
John
ever stop existing.
Families.
I didn't really like, I mean,
so
I was trying to think of like where I was coming from that angle, but I guess that's what it really was.
When he needs to throw up, he puts up Modern Family.
Yeah. I watch Marriage Story. No, I'm just saying.
Just give me an Toretto. MCU. I can see the MCU adding in these kids. They need the kids. The kids that give you that the viewpoint of a child, and it's the MCU, and this is Disney.
You're talking about Franklin, no,
like Franklin Richards? And yeah. Franklin Richards and Valeria.
Yeah, that's what you meant. I was like, man, that would be cool if they were kids. Like, Ben Grimm, no, like they were younger on the younger side.
That's straight for the Disney Channel.
That's Josh Trank reboot.
I think that's where Disney's gonna like. That's gonna be like one of the biggest hitters because they could do like the family thing, like the adventure thing.
Yeah.
Toretto. Yeah. Like, just look at the Incredibles, you know, Incredible 1 and 2.
Yeah. It's
just
like, introduce a child who is the strongest being in the universe. Like, kids love that. You're saying this because
you have a family.
No, I'm saying it because I love family.
I have no family. My brother's not sitting right here.
I hate family.
My dad's like that dead doctor. So.
Did we just laugh at his dead dad? What the hell is wrong with us?
I agree, though, because there is already like a second generation of MCU, and if you can't keep there's something exciting about a future where there's
the Furious movies all about family. They're gonna keep going
forever. Por vida. All right, well, I guess I'll say what I think. I would say something nice about this movie.
It stinks, like the critic.
It stinks. This movie is a stretch, Mr. Fantastic.
It's also hard.
I wish I didn't see it, Mr. Invisible Woman.
It's Mr. Invisible Woman.
Makes me hot. Human Torch. Let's see what else I got. It's not my thing.
It's not that electrifying.
Let's see, what else do I got?
There's a look into the writing process of this film.
These jokes are in the movie. They're better. No, I think there is
this movie
a weird
was doomed from the start.
I think I read somewhere that someone said there's an air of mediocrity around this movie that you can't just escape. And I think it's true. I think there's just a weird feeling you get watching it that everything just is connected loosely by the barely, you know, connected. But I think it's always good to see the Fantastic Four anywhere. They're one of the first to have this group dynamic. I just am not sure if they, I don't know. Like, I think something you see in team 'em up movies like Guardians of the Galaxy, the Justice League, Avengers. Let's see what else.
X-Men.
Suicide Squad. A lot of those, the thing that we see in all those movies.
The what?
Is, you know, they're strong as individuals, but they're even stronger as a team. Mm-hmm. But that wasn't something that was in this movie.
No, I mean, yeah, they try to shoehorn that thing right at the very, I don't know if it's shoehorn. I mean, it kind of like, they try to really do it at the very end, and it kind of, at that point, it's a little too late. It kind of works, sort of, but like, John's shaking his head.
If you see this movie in the lens of being a positive movie, that's fun. The lens of a child, you'll enjoy this movie because it is a joyful movie. It's a funny movie, and you have to expect that from this movie. I will break it down, and this is the last thing I'll say about this, and I will never talk about Fantastic Four ever again. But this movie, if there's a scene that encapsulates this movie for me, and that's when the human...
It's that four at the very end.
I know, four.
He spins.
The title. Yeah. It's when Human Torch tortures himself. He gets hot right out of the motocross scene.
Supernova?
Oh. And the thing punches him through
Mr. Fantastic,
and the Human Torch lands on a Burger King ad, leaving the burger
char-grilled
on the background. That's the movie. Like, that's the kind of movie this is. It's
there was a lot of product placement. Like, Xbox was on there.
That's true. When the thing woke up, he looks at the water bottle next to him with the label out for like a minute, and then looks back, and that water bottle is in a ton of this movie. But that's the movie. Like, if you are going in knowing you're gonna see like ads. The best ads
there was,
Then that's what you like. It's a very fun movie. It's a silly movie, and that's what this is.
And
it's full on silly.
I agree with you too. Like, it's really good. It's nice to see the Fantastic Four in any,
but also
in any iteration.
Their
really
deserve better.
Yeah, they do. Their characters still deserve better.
Yeah.
So we're waiting, Marvel.
But cool. All right. Well.
But cool.
I don't know if we're going to talk about Silver Surfer at some point. I'm sure we're going to talk about Fantastic Four later on. We may even watch the first Fantastic Four.
Yes, I was thinking that's going to be fun to watch.
Didn't today they just say James Gunn announced something about Galactus and Silver Surfer?
No, it was fake.
It was fake news. Yeah. Okay. I saw it on my thing. I was just like, I didn't click into it. I was just like, okay.
I really hope, like, I mean, see, I don't, I guess we can establish these characters, but like, if something trippy happens in like Doctor Strange, where they just literally pull the Fantastic Four from a different universe into theirs, that'd be okay with that too.
Would you guys want another origin story for the Fantastic Four? Or no. Do you think after three you're good?
I think we already know what the fuck is up. Like, I'm annoyed that we're probably gonna get another Batman origin like that. Like,
well, yeah, like, I think like, well, Spider-Man did get an origin story.
Yeah,
like we just like, yeah, it's like you already know.
They kind of already know.
They didn't want to kill Ben again.
Well, I mean, it's hinted that something happened, because I think it, I mean, also because isn't one of the lines from like Homecoming is like, not everything after everything that Aunt May has gone through, and like, it's supposed to imply that
like, yeah, we already know
maybe Ben's out there still,
but
maybe
he left her.
Maybe Ben was a spy.
I thought Ben should be Tobey Maguire.
I thought the perfect way to introduce the Fantastic Four into the MCU would have been something like, like the Infinity Gauntlet, like, mutated someone nearby, like four people nearby or something, and that would have been pretty cool.
I always thought it would be cool, like, if they had like the zombies, the Marvel zombies, and then like the Fantastic Four from a different universe come in.
Yeah, yeah.
So like, we're trying to stop this from hitting your universe.
You know? That would be really awesome.
That's a really good spreading idea.
Across from
now we're here to stay.
Well, because they'd go into the negative zone and stuff like that. Yeah, so like, well, Fantastic Four can do
Marvel zombies
some of that shit.
Worked is just like, it was from one universe. The Fantastic Four met their universe.
Yeah,
and you know,
they
like
met Magneto
it was,
there. Yeah, I remember
they
that.
They were going through different, you know.
What's exciting is we. I think in the last two decades, we always knew Fantastic Four was going, a new one was going to be made regardless, because the deal was they had to make one every 10 years. So that's why we saw many iterations of it. But now that it's all under one big tentpole, Marvel can wait as long as they want now to put one out.
They really can. And I think they're going to sit on it for a while. Like, it's not like, I think all this stuff is like ideal thinking we're going to get, but like, you know, I don't think we're going to get Fantastic Four anytime
2024.
The only reason why Trank made one was because Jessica Alba didn't want to do another one. So they had to go and redo another, you know.
Oh shit, I forgot that one came
out. Fantastic Four. So that's why
you're talking about the Kate Marwan, the Josh Trank one?
Yeah. So the reason why that even existed was they didn't want to lose the rights, and none of the original cast wanted to.
Hey, it came back around full circle.
Came back around for turn circle.
Also, Trank, apparently wanted to, like, I remember these Tranks.
Are we going to do the Trank one or what?
I don't know. It's just it's not fun to watch. Like that one, like, unlike this one. No, because this one, I mean, it's weird because like this one's not as like.
It's not as fun as Joker.
It might as well be like.
Because had a great time at Joker
Society.
I don't know, because I remember watching that Josh Trank one, like, and I was like, "Yeah, it's not too bad." And then I remember rewatching it later, like on cable TV, and I was like, "This is bad."
John's like a Josh Trank, more like Josh Hanked. Spank would have been Spank.
And yeah, and then movie didn't do a whole lot for his career too. Like, it kind of like blew the doors off like, of like what
Josh
actually happened.
Drank before making this movie.
Josh Skank.
He didn't like it. Yeah, I mean, because it was taken away from him, and then he like bashed it online, and like, you know.
Well, sounds like we should do it. Sounds like it's gonna be fun.
Okay, we can make it as like a companion episode to this or something. Maybe to Patreon.
Josh Bank. He did not.
Okay. Well, let's go around the horn, give our plugs, and yeah, anything that you guys want to do.
I want to say something.
Oh.
About non MCU, like, well, the theme to your like, was it Phase 4?
Mm-hmm.
Sure.
Volume four. No. I'm sorry.
Jury's still
Part
out.
Four. Well, like, non MCU movies is something that I do miss.
3.5.
The soundtracks. And I always think, like, okay, like Spider-Man, when Spider-Man came out.
They say that.
Exactly. Hero came out.
You're talking about those types of soundtracks?
Yeah, like that's something that MCU does music. Not have, you know, like, so there was Hero and like Fantastic Four, Velvet Revolvers, Come In.
Yeah, but also Guardians of the Galaxy was like one of the number one albums of the decade.
Yeah, but that's just like rehashing. This is just.
You want original.
Like, they had bands coming out, you know, like they had, like, the Punisher had Seether and Amy Lee Broken.
Transformers did. Linkin Park.
Yeah, that's exactly. Like
Captain 90s. Marvel, no doubt.
No.
2000. That's a very 2000s trope. Like, yeah, like having a movie tie-in.
I missed that. Yeah. Like, those non-MCU movies, like, they would hype me up when I would, like, watch, you know, like, TV and I see the music video. and I would fuck it.
You know, oh, this is going to be a
Evanescence
really,
in Daredevil. 41.
This is going to be a really boring breakdown, but Sony has a record label, and so did Fox for a while. So they would marry an artist in their studio.
Right, yeah, I know that.
With a movie, and unless you want some Disney Channel.
Well, Sony recently did that with Sunflower, with Post Malone.
Yeah.
And that was, like, amazing.
It worked so well for Suicide Squad.
Huh? Oh, yeah, that's Andrew's favorite.
Well, also Venom, Ethan's. Like, Venom also probably had, like, Eminem came out
just
like,
saying the title character.
That's something Venom. But that's what I'm saying is, like, MCU does not do that. Like, I'm just I kind of cool miss that.
Like, know, actually, like,
I don't know who.
What's this only because it's like it's a little weird. It's gimmicky. Like, you can totally tell it's like very, very gimmicky when something.
They're gonna do the Beauty and the Beast song. What does Disney own? I don't know.
Tale as old as time. Yeah, like a lot of old school, like not old school, just 2000s. It's a very 2000s trope where you do the, like, it's like what you said, like, you know,
the soundtrack.
We watch, like, you know, if you watch Daredevil, like, it's just literally there's an Evanescence song
every life. And they also played it in the movies, like like I said earlier, they played it when the Human Torch was on his motorcycle, you know.
Yeah.
They played it in the Punisher. You could hear it in the background, like, broken.
Yeah, yeah, you can hear.
Like,
yeah,
it's just really.
Roy, it sounds like you should be writing a song.
I'm sure Ghost Rider has one also.
No, I don't think.
Ghost Rider's in the sky. They like
that's a fucking song. Everything non-Disney had one because they and it's not just Marvel movies too. I think it was just
it was everywhere.
Yeah,
like, it has. I mean,
X-Men,
Fast and the Furious still does that now.
Yeah,
and so
it's
like, you know,
been a long
too soon,
family.
For what
is it? Toretto.
Corona. Virus.
They drank Coronas.
Okay, cool.
That's a funny thing.
To our listeners in China.
Jesus Christ.
We give you great honor. Hold on, let me.
You need to cut that out, like, big time. Plugs. I don't actually have anything to plug.
Wait, give me some more time to cut out.
Oh, okay.
All right, that's good. How about we start with John?
Yeah.
What do you have to plug, John?
I don't have anything right now.
Cool. Roy, what do you have to plug? Did you finish that giant beer?
Yeah, I'm pretty buzzed right now. Like, yeah. It's two beers. Like, this is like
it's a big beer.
He's 32 ouncer?
Yeah, I'm not leaving. No, I'm staying here.
I'm going to put on Fantastic Four and watch it again.
I actually do want to watch the Rise of the Silver Surfer or the 2015 one after we start recording here.
I don't like that because Galactus was a cloud. Kind of like Green Lantern.
He was just a fart.
Galactus.
Cloud.
Him and Parallax were farts.
Yeah, pretty much.
It's weird because if MCU did do one, if we don't count the original one that's lost to time, that would be the fourth Fantastic Four. So it would actually be Fantastic Four.
Yeah.
Four.
Four.
44?
Yeah. They're going to call it Fantastic Four. Four.
Yeah, 4.4.
Yeah.
Four.
Fast and Furious, they're not consistent with their titles ever. It's F7, Fast 9, Fast and Furious
F9.
6.
No, it's just F9, right?
Is that what this one is?
You got to hit Control-Alt-F9.
It's fine.
Yeah, it's fine.
I don't have the F buttons on my computer anymore. Roy, what was that?
I have no plugs.
Oh, man, it's just your buzz.
Yeah. I can't think right now.
Shout out to this beer. So
if you're listening, can shout you pick up Roy?
Shout out to
still,
Corona.
He's still
my Uber's here.
I want to go ahead and plug Roy's liver. It is working its ass off right now.
I'm going to plug up his dick so that because you got to piss this thing out.
What just happened?
Yeah,
I don't know how that works.
Another idea for
you gotta pinch off the hose.
I have no idea where that joke is going.
The hose.
This is how you can tell Andrew doesn't drink. He thinks if you want to stay drunk longer, you have to plug your penis. Yeah.
You gotta hold the liquid in, and that's how the alcohol just absorbs into your skin, your blood, right? The longer you keep it in, the more drunk you are.
I'm trying to bulk up, so I plug my butt.
Yeah, I knew it.
Gotta keep it in there.
That's not why you plug your butt.
No, that's it's. They asked me, why are you plugging up your butt? Is it work or pleasure? And I say, a little of both. Yeah. This is at the airport.
Oh, shit.
John?
Just listen to all your Delphin Pod podcasts. Listen to Revenge of the Sequel.
Would you say they equal this in quality?
Yes, I listen to them.
Nice.
This is a very different vibe, but like totally. Sort of. I mean, they're
not
very
as
both,
much of us
they're
here,
both
I think,
us.
Usually.
Yeah. So like, I mean, it's the same thing. Maybe less games on Revenge of the Sequel,
but play games on Revenge of the Sequel.
we don't movies play. Usually at are the games. Yeah. Like,
oh shit,
the movie's the game.
That means the movie sucks.
Yeah, sometimes.
Oh, shots fired, Dark Knight, Chris Nolan.
Ooh, Zombieland Double Tap. Oh, Zombie wait, that's Land. Not even out yet.
I've been waiting for that one.
Oh, see, we got some demand.
I was messaging Andrew like, when is it going to drop?
Never.
He was sliding in my DMs.
That's pretty much all my plugs, actually.
Andrew?
Well, me and John, the H-list John, work at a comic book shop, and we totally have better Fantastic Four stories than the script. This movie and any movies, I guess.
Yeah,
any of the Fantastic Four movies, and so yeah,
it's still there. Still new issues of Fantastic.
Oh yeah, for
Four.
Sure.
Is it really?
Yeah.
You better bet. You bet your sweet. They did buttery biscuit ass.
They got Spite canceled for like 2 years.
Though. Yeah, because they're like, nope, yeah, Fox still owns us. Nope.
But that's over.
1961. Yep. The first Fantastic Four came out.
The very first Marvel superhero
team mom up
was the Human Torch, but it's not the Johnny Storm and one, but it was a Human Torch.
Interesting. I was listening to the Marvel versus DC podcast, and it goes across the whole history, and you think, you know, oh, Fantastic Four, they put a lot of thought into it, and Stanley literally was just like, ah, we got to have something against Justice League. Mm-hmm. And they were like, okay,
that's the way Stanley did it a lot.
Yeah.
Even like,
he was like, the Doom Patrol came out, oh my God, I got to create the X-Men.
Yes, I forgot about the Doom Patrol predating X-Men. That's kind of crazy.
It's like three or four months.
Yeah.
It's kind of like the Swamp Thing, Man-Thing thing, where Man-Thing came out first, and then 3 months later, or 4 months later, Swamp Thing came out.
You know, Doom Patrol probably more than the Justice League and Avengers is a great it's a similar thing. It's a very old team. But it doesn't feel as dated as the Fantastic Four we just watched, which is weird.
Yeah, I mean, cause there's not a whole lot of stuff that was done with Doom Patrol other than like comic stuff. So like that's why it's kind of. But I forget that like the original band of weirdos was like the like everything that comes afterwards, like X-Men, Guardians of the Galaxy. They started with Doom Patrol, which was kind of cool.
Listen to this podcast. Congrats, you did it.
You just did.
Or go to patreon.com/delphinpod. Listen to exclusive content like advanced episodes of this show and other exclusive stuff. And it supports the pod. You can go to tpublic.com. And if you search for Delphin Pod, there are shirts there, magnets, things like that. And all of that supports the pod
well.
And I'm sure that there's other things now. I don't know when you're hearing this. It could be March. It could be who knows.
It's pretty funny. You're like, well, it may not be there.
Unless you're on Patreon, you're hearing this.
Pretty live. Close, yeah. ASAP Rocky.
This is live. You're listening to this in the past.
In the present?
What's better?
Yeah. Huge shout out. Thanks to John and Roy for being on the podcast.
John and Roy.
You're welcome.
Yeah, you made talking about Fantastic Four very enjoyable.
More bearable.
And there honestly, there were going to be four people here, but John, just like Palpatine himself...
Back from the dead.
That's true. Yeah, that's. I guess we didn't talk about that. That's why there were so many people on this podcast because I was not supposed to be on this episode.
Yeah. But we're not going to explain how we came back.
The flu.
John speaks.
I was like, that's it.
Yeah.
The John speaks.
Yeah.
The rest speaks.
You got to say it like Jar Jar. Talking. John spake.
John. Well, that's Oddworld.
Okay.
Okay.
Later.